shock known as cardiogenic shock, and this is the third type of circulatory shock. And the last, fourth type is obstructive shock. So any obstruction in the circulatory system may lead to inadequate blood flow, and this type of circulatory shock is obstructive shock. So hypovolemic, vasogenic, distributive or low resistance shock, cardiogenic and obstructive shock. These are the four major types of circulatory shock. Now we will discuss the etiology of each type of circulatory shock. We will start with the hypovolemic shock. So what happens in hypovolemia? Due to blood loss, there may be hemorrhagic shock. Now this hemorrhagic shock is sometimes due to any abnormal condition. Sometimes it may be traumatic. Traumatic shock, any roadside accident may lead to loss of significant quantity of blood. So we will label it as traumatic shock. Similarly, blood loss can be there during surgical procedure. So we can call it as the surgical shock. In cases of burns, there is loss of body fluids, especially loss of plasma fluid. So we will label it as burn shock. And then there is shock due to dehydration. So these are the five important causes of hypovolemia, which may lead to hypovolemic shock. Hemorrhage or blood loss may lead to hypovolemia. This hemorrhage may be due to any abnormality within the circulatory system. This hemorrhage may be due to trauma or roadside accident. This hemorrhage may be due to any surgical procedure. Similarly, there is loss of plasma fluid during burn, and dehydration sometimes may lead to hypovolemic shock. Now, this dehydration can be due to excessive vomiting or excessive diarrhea. So excessive diarrhea, excessive vomiting, excessive sweating sometimes lead to dehydration, and this may lead to hypovolemic shock. So these are the five important causes of hypovolemic shock. Then is the vasogenic shock. As we have discussed earlier, vasogenic shock is sometimes known as low resistance shock or distributive shock. And the three major types of vasogenic shock include neurogenic shock, the second is the anaphylactic shock, and the third is septicemic shock or simply septic shock. And the collective terminologies for these three types of shock is vasogenic shock. You can say these are the subtypes of vasogenic shock. The pathophysiology in each of these subtypes is different. We will discuss the details later. Now, cardiogenic shock may be due to any abnormality within the heart itself. If there is any abnormality in the rhythm of the heart or arrhythmia is there, this may lead to circulatory shock. If there is heart failure, again, it may lead to shock. If there is ischemia or improper or inadequate perfusion to the heart muscle, this may again lead to the type of circulatory shock. And all these types in which the source of origin, the pathology is within the heart, is labeled as cardiogenic shock. And the last is obstructive shock. Now this obstruction can be anywhere within the circulatory system. So any obstruction within the circulatory system will cause inadequate blood flow. Hence, it will lead to circulatory shock. But the most important causes of obstruction is due to pulmonary embolism. If there is any emboli within the pulmonary system, this may lead to improper or inadequate blood flow. Similarly, if there is any compression, pericardial effusion and compression of the heart, that is cardiac tamponade, again, this may lead to obstruction. So if there is any obstruction, this may lead to obstructive shock. And the two most important causes of obstructive shock include shock due to cardiac tamponade and shock due to pulmonary embolism. Now, what are the clinical features of hypovolemic shock? Hypovolemia, as the name indicates, we have discussed. Hypovolemia is reduced quantity of body fluids. So if the body fluid is on the lower side, obviously the cardiac output will be on the lower side. So decreased cardiac output is the first and foremost clinical feature of hypovolemic shock. Similarly, since the blood volume is on the lower side, the arterial pressure will be low as well. Due to decreased arterial pressure, the peripheral pulses will be weak, or we use the term feeble pulse or thready pulse, especially the peripheral pulses, the radial pulses especially. So in patients of hypovolemic shock, if you palpate the radial artery or radial pulse, you may find it very difficult to palpate. And if the blood loss is significant, so you have to switch from peripheral pulses to the carotid pulse. So not only the arterial pressure and the pulses are weak, but the skin is due to low cardiac output and decreased temperature is very cold and pale looking. The other clinical feature or the other sign for hypovolemic shock is tachypnea. Tachypnea in simple words means increased breathing rate. So this is a compensatory mechanism. So all these are the clinical features of hypovolemic shock due to significant loss of blood or body fluids, the cardiac output, the arterial pressure. All these parameters will be on the lower side. The peripheral pulses will be feeble and the compensatory effect is tachypnea. And this will lead to restlessness or lethargy or easy fatigability. So we can use the word deplete as a mnemonic for volume depletion. So in hypovolemia, there is dry mucous membrane. The extremities are cold. The pulses are feeble, loss of weight is there, loss of electrolytes is there, tachycardia is there. Again, tachycardia is increased heart rate. This is again a compensatory effect. When the volume of blood is on the lower side, the peripheral pulses are weak. This is a compensatory effect. The heart rate will increase slightly and elasticity of the skin is reduced due to loss of body fluids. So these are the important clinical features, or you can say the signs and symptoms of hypovolemia or hypovolemic shock. So you can see the normal circulatory system. This is the venous side. The blue side is the venous side and the red side is the arterial side, the oxygenated side. And normally what happens, this is the venous side. You can see the direction of blood flow from the peripheral venous pool towards the right atrium. You can see the filling of the heart is adequate enough for normal cardiac output. And this blood is pumped by the left ventricle into the arterial system. Hence, all the organs of the body are supplied with adequate amount of blood. This is in a normal healthy individual. So what happens in hypovolemic shock? Suppose there is roadside accident, a motorbike accident, and there is fracture of left tibia and significant quantity of blood, 1 to 2 liter of blood is lost. So you can see blood is lost here. So this will impair the filling of the heart. You can compare it with the normal filling. Since the filling is impaired, the cardiac output will be compromised as well. You can compare the cardiac output, but the left ventricle is compromised. Hence, all the organs will be supplied by inadequate amount of blood. So this is the pathophysiology of hypovolemic shock. So you can compare normal individual with that of a patient of hypovolemic shock. So in hypovolemic shock, the cardiac output is low because the venous filling is impaired, the blood loss is there, and all the organs are supplied by inadequate amount of blood. So you're not required to memorize the classes of hypovolemic shock. This table is just to show different signs in a patient of hypovolemic shock. And the signs may get severe, or the patient may get serious progressively. As you can see, the percentage increases, the blood volume loss. If the blood volume loss is 10 to 15%, there may be no signs of hypovolemic shock. Similarly, if there is significant loss of body fluid or blood, this may lead to fatal consequences. So you can compare the pulse rate, the systolic pressure, the pulse pressure, the respiratory rate, the urinary output in a patient of hypovolemic shock. So the normal patient, the patient with minimum blood volume loss may present normally. You can see all the parameters are within the normal range because the blood volume lost is not that significant. If there is 15 to 20% or more than 20% blood volume loss, you can see tachycardia, increase in heart rate. Tachycardia is there. Not only the heart rate is increased, the breathing rate is also increased. Tachypnea, so tachycardia will be there, and tachypnea will be there. Arterial pressure, especially the systolic pressure, will progressively fall from normal, right? Similarly, there will be progressive decrease in the pulse pressure, which is the difference between systolic and diastolic. And the capillary refill time will be abnormal as well. So normally, the capillary refill is there within few seconds. You can see there is delayed capillary refill if the blood volume lost is significant, or it may be absent if there is more than 40% of blood loss. So these are the cardiovascular parameters. You can observe different signs in the nervous system as well. You can see there is no signs of confusion in normal patient, or if the blood loss is minimal, but as there is progressive increase in blood volume loss, you can see the patient starts getting anxious and confused. And if there is significant blood loss, this may lead to coma as well. And this is a very serious condition. If left untreated, this may lead to fatal consequences. So due to hypovolemia, the urinary output is compromised. Again, this is a compensatory mechanism of the body to minimize loss of body fluids. Because the body fluids are already on the lower side, so the urinary output will compensate. So you can see there is decreased urinary output in hypovolemic shock. And if there is more blood volume lost, the urinary output sometimes is almost negligible. So these are the different clinical parameters related to cardiovascular system, CNS, and renal system in a patient of hypovolemic shock. So in a patient of hypovolemic shock, the heart rate will be increased, that is tachycardia. The respiratory rate will increase, that is tachypnea. The cardiac output is low, hence there will be drop in the arterial pressure, especially the systolic pressure and the pulse pressure. There are changes in the CNS, the patient will be confused, or sometimes the patient may present in a state of coma, and the urinary output will be compromised as well. So we have discussed the first type of shock, hypovolemic shock. Now we will discuss the second type, that is vasogenic shock, also known as low resistance shock or distributed shock. So whenever we use the term vasogenic shock, we are referring to three types of circulatory shock, and these three types are neurogenic shock, anaphylactic shock, and septic shock. So neurogenic, anaphylactic, and septic shock, the collective terminology for these three types of shock is vasogenic or low resistance shock. So what happens in low resistance shock or vasogenic shock? As the name indicates, in vasogenic shock, the pathology is within the blood vessels, vasogenic. So there is loss of vasomotor tone. So we call it as vasogenic because the vasomotor tone is lost. And the sympathetic nervous system is responsible for maintaining partial state of contraction of the smooth muscles of the blood vessels. And if the sympathetic nervous system is not adequate enough, this may lead to loss of vasomotor tone. And this will cause pooling of blood in the peripheral venous system. You can see the vasomotor tone is lost, so all the blood is pooled up here in the peripheral vessels. And this will cause decrease in the cardiac output and the arterial pressure as well. So we will discuss the three types of vasogenic shock one by one. We will start with the neurogenic shock first. Neurogenic shock is as characterized by depression of the nervous system. As the name indicates, neurogenic shock is due to depression of the neurons or the nervous system due to loss of vasomotor tone. So whenever there is loss of vasomotor tone, the blood vessels, especially the veins, will dilate. And this is known as vasodilation or vasodilatation. So vasodilatation will lead to increased vascular compliance or increased vascular capacity. So whenever the vascular compliance or vascular capacity is increased, the tone is lost, this will cause decrease in the MSFP. We have discussed what is MSFP, that is mean systemic filling pressure. And mean systemic filling pressure is related to the volume and the capacity of the blood vessels. So whenever the vascular capacity is compromised, this will cause drop in the MSFP, and hence the venous return will drop. This is the pathophysiology of neurogenic shock. Remember, loss of vasomotor tone causes vasodilatation. Vasodilatation causes increased vascular capacity, followed by decrease in MSFP and venous return. And the common causes of neurogenic shock include anesthesia, any type of anesthesia, especially general anesthesia or spinal anesthesia, or any type of brain trauma will cause neurogenic shock. In all these cases, anesthesia, general, spinal, and brain trauma, what happens? There is loss of signals from the vasomotor center. So when the vasomotor center is paralyzed, there will be loss of vasomotor tone, and this may lead to neurogenic shock. So we have discussed the two types of circulatory shock, hypovolemic shock and neurogenic shock. The second type of vasogenic shock is anaphylactic shock. And what is meant by the term anaphylaxis? Anaphylaxis in simple words means allergic response to a foreign body. And so any type of circulatory shock that develops due to this anaphylactic reaction will be labeled as anaphylactic shock. So what happens in anaphylactic shock? There is vasodilatation and sudden fall in the blood pressure. And the most important chemical released during anaphylactic reaction is histamine. Histamine, as we all know, is a potent vasodilator. So whenever there is anaphylactic reaction or allergic response in our body, there will be release of this chemical agent, histamine. This is a potent vasodilator. This will cause vasodilatation, and the blood pressure, the arterial pressure, will suddenly drop. And the drop in the arterial pressure will cause anaphylactic shock. So any type of circulatory shock due to anaphylactic reaction or response will be labeled as anaphylactic shock. And the third type of vasogenic shock is the septic shock. Remember, neurogenic, anaphylactic, and septic shock, although the pathophysiology is different in each of these three types of shock, but these are the subtypes of the same vasogenic shock. So we have discussed neurogenic and anaphylactic shock, and the third and the last type or subtype of vasogenic shock is the septic shock or septicemic shock. So what is meant by the term sepsis? So sepsis is a pathological condition characterized by any pathogen. So any pathogen or any toxin released by any pathogen in the blood will lead to sepsis, or sometimes this is known as blood poisoning. And the common causes include any infection or inflammation in the peritoneum, peritonitis, any streptococcal infection or staphylococcal infection. These are the two important types of bacteria. Any gangrenous infection, any type of infection in the urinary tract, this may lead to sepsis, and the type of shock due to sepsis is known as septicemic shock, septicemia, or septic shock. So septic shock has some unique clinical features if we compare this shock with other types of circulatory shock. And the unique features include high grade fever. So since there is infection of due to any bacterial infection, the hypothalamus is affected, and this will cause increase in the body temperature. The vasodilatation is there throughout the body, and this is the type of shock in which the cardiac output is increased. Now this is a paradox. Although the patient is in shock, but the cardiac output is on the higher side. So this is one of the unique features of septic shock, that is, the cardiac output is high. High cardiac output despite the patient being in a state of shock. And the reason for this high cardiac output is the release of toxins. Potent toxins are released by the bacteria, and these toxins, they increase the metabolic rate of the body, and this will increase the cardiac output. Moreover, there will be red cell agglutination or sludging of blood, and this red cell agglutination sometimes lead to development of microclots. And if these microclots, they disseminate throughout the circulatory system, we will label the condition as disseminated intravascular coagulation, or simply DIC. So the important clinical features of septic shock, remember, is number one, high grade fever will be there. Vasodilatation will be there. This vasodilatation is present throughout the body. And there are different types of toxins which are released by the bacteria. And these toxins will disturb the metabolic rate, and the cardiac output will increase. Moreover, due to red cell agglutination, microclots will develop, and this sometimes lead to disseminated intravascular coagulation. So we have discussed the two types of circulatory shock. We have discussed hypovolemic shock so far. What are the clinical features, signs and symptoms of hypovolemic shock? What are the different causes of hypovolemia? And we have also discussed the second type, vasogenic shock. So vasogenic shock or low resistance shock includes neurogenic shock, anaphylactic shock, and the third one is septic shock. So the third type of circulatory shock is cardiogenic shock. Remember, the pathology is within the heart. The pathology lies in the heart itself. So any shock due to cardiac pathology, cardiac abnormality will be labeled as cardiogenic shock. Now this cardiogenic shock may be due to abnormal rhythm of the heart or arrhythmia, atrial fibrillation or ventricular fibrillation. This cardiogenic shock may be due to myocardial ischemia, or this cardiogenic shock may be due to congestive cardiac diseases. So these are the three important causes of cardiogenic shock: arrhythmia, myocardial ischemia, and congestive cardiac disease. And the fourth type of circulatory shock, fourth and the last type of circulatory shock, is obstructive shock. So if there is any obstruction within the circulatory system, this may lead to obstructive shock. And the most important causes of obstruction include cardiac tamponade and pulmonary embolism. So cardiac tamponade is due to pericardial effusion. What is pericardial effusion? Abnormal, severe, or excessive accumulation of pericardial fluid around the heart is pericardial effusion. And this pericardial effusion sometimes lead to compression of the heart from the outside. And this compression of the heart is known as cardiac tamponade. So this is another type of obstructive shock, cardiac tamponade. So in cardiac tamponade, the obstruction is around the heart. Sometimes the obstruction is in the blood vessels, especially the blood vessels of the lungs, the pulmonary arteries. So if there is any thrombus or any embolus within the pulmonary system, this is known as pulmonary embolism, and this again may lead to obstruction or obstructive shock. So we have discussed all the types of circulatory shock. Now we will summarize the types one by one. Inadequate blood flow is labeled as circulatory shock. Hypovolemic shock, hypovolemia can be due to blood loss or hemorrhage. Hypovolemia can be due to any trauma or roadside accident. Burns can also lead to hypovolemic shock. Dehydration, for example, excessive diarrhea, excessive vomiting, excessive sweating may lead to hypovolemia. So in hypovolemic shock, the skin will be cold and clammy. The cardiac output will be compromised. And then the TPR will be increased. So what is TPR? Total peripheral resistance. So total peripheral resistance includes the resistance not only in the circulatory system but also in the pulmonary system. So total peripheral resistance includes systemic vascular resistance, SVR, and pulmonary vascular resistance, PVR. But generally speaking, whenever we use the term SVR, we are referring to TPR. So TPR and SVR, systemic vascular resistance and total peripheral resistance, these are interchangeable terms. So the other term is the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is the pressure inside the pulmonary capillaries. And this pressure inside the pulmonary capillaries is indicative of the pressure inside the left atrium. Just like CVP or JVP is the indicator for the pressure inside the right atrium, pulmonary capillary pressure or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is indicative of the pressure inside the left atrium. So the pressure inside the left atrium or the capillary pressure, wedge pressure will be on the lower side. Why? Because there is already loss of significant volume of fluids. So the pressure in the right and left atria will be on the lower side as well. So we will treat the shock by treating the cause. Obviously, we will treat the cause and we will stabilize the patient by giving intravenous fluids in hypovolemic shock. Next is cardiogenic shock. Now this cardiogenic shock can be due to arrhythmia, can be due to myocardial ischemia. So in cardiogenic shock, again, the cardiac output is on the lower side. The total peripheral resistance is increased. And obstructive shock, whether the obstruction is due to cardiac tamponade or whether the obstruction is due to pulmonary embolism. Again, the skin will be cold and clammy. The cardiac output will be significantly low due to obstruction. The total peripheral resistance is increased and we will treat the cause. We will relieve the obstruction. Wherever there is obstruction, we will try to relieve the obstruction and stabilize the patient. So in cardiogenic shock, we use inotropic drugs. Inotropes are the drugs which cause inotropism. And inotropy is force of contraction of the heart. So these drugs, they tend to increase the force of contraction of the heart. And the idea is to increase the cardiac output. If you increase the force of contraction, you are increasing the cardiac output. Secondly, we use diuretics. Diuresis is the opposite of diuresis in simple words, minimizing body fluid loss through the urinary tract. And in obstructive shock, and in distributive shock, again, now this distributive shock includes septic shock, it includes anaphylactic shock or neurogenic shock, and the collective term is distributive shock. Again, you can see in septic shock, the body temperature is increased, and we have discussed why there is high grade fever in septic shock. This is the unique feature of septic shock, high body temperature or high grade fever. In the rest of the shock, the skin is cold and clammy, but in septic shock, mainly the skin is warm. So this is one of the unique features of septic shock. The other unique feature of septic and anaphylactic shock is increase in the cardiac output here. So you can see in septic shock, the cardiac output is increased. Rest of the shocks, they show decrease in the cardiac output, but septic shock and anaphylactic shock, the cardiac output is increased. That is why these two types of distributive shock are sometimes labeled as high cardiac output shock. So sometimes we can classify shock on the basis of cardiac output as well. For example, we can classify shock as low cardiac output shock and high cardiac output shock. So all the types of circulatory shock that we have discussed earlier are low cardiac output, but the cardiac output in septicemia is increased. Similarly, the cardiac output during allergic responses or anaphylaxis is increased. So septic shock and anaphylactic shock, they are sometimes labeled as high cardiac output shock. So in septic shock, we will give intravenous fluids. In anaphylactic shock and in neurogenic shock, we may use adrenaline for anaphylaxis, adrenaline or epinephrine. So you can observe total peripheral resistance or systemic vascular resistance. So TPR is another important parameter that we have to look during different types of circulatory shock, TPR or SVR. So distributive shock is known as low resistance shock. The other name for vasogenic shock and distributive shock is low resistance shock. Why we call it as low resistance shock? Because the total peripheral resistance is decreased here. You can see in rest of the types, hypovolemic shock, TPR is increased, cardiogenic shock, TPR is increased, cardiac tamponade, pulmonary embolism. Again, in all these conditions, the total peripheral resistance is increased. Why TPR is increased? Because the cardiac output is low. So to compensate the decrease in the cardiac output, the resistance in the peripheral vessels is increased. So this is again a compensatory mechanism due to sympathetic activation. Since there is loss of vasomotor tone in distributive shock, so paralysis of vasomotor center is there, loss of vasomotor tone is there. That is why the total peripheral resistance, TPR, is significant in distributive shock. So again, this is a unique feature of distributive shock, and this is exhibited by all the three subtypes of vasogenic or distributive: septic, anaphylactic, and neurogenic. In all the three subtypes of distributive shock, the total peripheral resistance is decreased due to loss of vasomotor tone. That is the reason distributive shock is also known as low resistance shock. So this is the last slide for today's session, and this is the summary of the whole discussion. So we have discussed hypovolemic shock, number one, the first type, cardiogenic shock, the second type, and then distributive shock. So anaphylactic shock, neurogenic shock, and septic shock, all these are known as distributive shock or low resistance shock. Similarly, the third is obstructive shock. Now this obstruction may be due to cardiac tamponade. This obstruction may be due to any obstruction in the pulmonary artery or pulmonary embolism. So these are the four major types of circulatory shock. You can see different types of parameters in each of the types. We will start with the cardiac output. So in each type of circulatory shock, whether there is hypovolemia or there is abnormal cardiac condition, or whether there is obstruction in the pulmonary vessels, in all the types of circulatory shock, the cardiac output is decreased. But septic shock and anaphylactic shock, they are unique in the sense that the cardiac output in these two types is increased. So in septic shock, different types of toxins are released, and these toxins, they alter the metabolic rate. Hence, the body temperature increases and the cardiac output increases. And some phenomenon happens in anaphylaxis. There is allergic response to foreign body, and this may increase the cardiac output. So in all the types of circulatory shock, except septic and anaphylactic, the cardiac output is on the lower side. So we can say septic shock and anaphylactic shock, these are the high cardiac output shock. Then we have discussed total peripheral resistance or systemic vascular resistance. So in distributive shock, in the three types of distributive shock, anaphylactic, neurogenic, and septic, the total peripheral resistance is decreased. In rest of the types, the TPR is significantly increased, and this increase in TPR is a sort of compensation due to decrease in cardiac output. But this compensation does not take place in distributive shock. Why? Because the vasomotor center is paralyzed, the vasomotor tone is lost. That is the reason the total peripheral resistance is on the lower side in the three types of distributive shock. So distributive shock or low resistance shock. So we have discussed two parameters, cardiac output and TPR. Now we will compare the pressure inside the left atrium and the pressure inside the right atrium. So JVP, jugular venous pulse, or CVP, central venous pulse. This is the indicative for the pressure inside the right atrium. So JVP or CVP is the pressure for right atrium. Whereas the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, also known as the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, this is the indicator for the pressure inside the left atrium. So we will compare the pressure inside the right and left atria in each of the subtypes of circulatory shock. So in hypovolemic shock, since the blood volume is minimal, that is the reason the pressure in the both atria, right and left, will be low. Similarly, in cardiogenic shock, there is abnormality of the heart. Whether there is arrhythmia, whether there is myocardial ischemia or myocardial infarction, the cardiac output is reduced and the TPR is increased and the pressure will be increased as well. So in cardiogenic shock, the pressure will be increased, not only in the right atrium but also in the left atrium. That is why the CVP and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure both will be increased. Similarly, in obstructive shock, especially in cardiac tamponade where there is compression from the outside, in cardiac tamponade, heart is compressed by the pericardial fluid from the outside, and this compression will increase the pressure in both the atria, right? Same is the reason for the increased CVP and pulmonary embolism as well. But in pulmonary embolism, although the CVP or the pressure inside the right atrium is increased, but the pressure inside the left atrium is on the lower side. Why? Because sometimes the embolus obstructs the pulmonary artery. So this will cause a drop in the following pulmonary capillary. Right. So we have discussed different types of circulatory shock. What are the causes of each type of circulatory shock? What are the clinical features? And what are the signs and symptoms? Now, if there is any question, please let me know. Nadeem, unmute kar de, question answer session.
I told you.
This is the last lecture of circulatory system. Students, circulatory shock is very important for examination point of view as well. If you have any query, please ask now, because this is the last lecture of
Thank you.
Okay, I have a question. Cardiac tamponade. What is cardiac tamponade? Cardiac tamponade is a sequence or sequentially due to pericardial effusion. So remember, the heart is enclosed by different types of layers known as pericardial layers, the inner layer and the outer layer, or the parietal and the visceral layer. And the space between these two layers is known as the pericardial space. And the fluid present within the pericardial space is known as pericardial fluid. Sometimes there is excessive accumulation of pericardial fluid within the pericardial space. And this abnormal excessive accumulation of pericardial fluid within the pericardial space is known as pericardial effusion. So whenever there is effusion, suppose this is the heart and this is the pericardial space. So abnormal accumulation of fluid around these pericardial layers will cause compression of the heart. So this will compress the heart from outside. So these compression symptoms develop due to accumulation of abnormal excessive pericardial fluid within the pericardial space. This will lead to cardiac tamponade. The condition is known as cardiac tamponade. So this will compress the heart from outside, and due to compression, there will be inadequate blood supply or inadequate blood flow to the heart, and the type of shock is known as obstructive shock. So cardiac tamponade sometimes may lead to obstructive shock. So obstructive shock is one of the complications of cardiac tamponade. Any other question? We still have 2 minutes. Please tell the slide number. Which slide you are referring to? Which slide number? So in this table, you can compare different parameters in each type of circulatory shock. We can compare the cardiac output. We can compare the total peripheral resistance. So cardiac output and total peripheral resistance are compared in these except septic shock and anaphylactic shock. Rest of the types of shock, they exhibit low cardiac output. So the cardiac output is low in hypovolemia because the blood volume is low. Similarly, cardiogenic shock, the cardiac output is low because there is abnormal pumping or decreased or improper pumping of the heart. Similarly, in cardiac tamponade, there is compression. This will compromise the cardiac output. Obstruction in the pulmonary system will compromise the cardiac output as well. But in anaphylactic and septic shock, the cardiac output is increased. So you can see increase in cardiac output in anaphylactic shock, increase in cardiac output in septic shock. So that is the reason these two types are known as high cardiac output shock. Now if we compare the total peripheral resistance, so increase in the total peripheral resistance is a sort of compensatory response due to decrease in cardiac output. And this compensatory response is not exhibited in distributive shock. So in the three subtypes, anaphylactic, neurogenic, and septic shock, there is loss of vasomotor tone due to loss of sympathetic stimulation. The vasomotor center is paralyzed. That is why the TPR is on the lower side. That is the reason this type of shock is also known as low resistance shock. So there will be decrease in TPR in low resistance shock. Otherwise, the TPR is increased as a compensatory response due to decreased cardiac output. Then the pressure inside the right atrium and the pressure inside the left atrium. CVP is the indicative for the pressure inside the right atrium, CVP or JVP, whereas the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is indicator for the pressure inside the left atrium. So you can see in cardiogenic shock and in cardiac tamponade, there is obstruction of the pulmonary artery or the pulmonary capillaries. That is the reason the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is increased. Rest of the shock, there is drop in the pulmonary capillary pressure or the left atrial pressure. In hypovolemic shock, not only the pressure inside the left atrium, but also pressure inside the right atrium is decreased. Why? Because the volume is not adequate enough to maintain pressure in either of the atria. So CVP and pulmonary capillary pressure will be reduced in hypovolemic shock. Both will be increased in cardiogenic shock and cardiac tamponade. In distributive shock, both these parameters are significantly reduced. So that's all for today's session. Thank you very much. Allah Hafiz.